For Krimo Media's Polity, I'm Tabi Madiba. Joining me today is author and activist Dr. Sizwe Mbofu-Walsh, here to speak about his book titled The New Apartheid. Congratulations on your latest book, The New Apartheid, in which you trace the new forms that apartheid have taken in post-1994 South Africa. You argue that apartheid did not die, it was privatized. Please explain to us what you mean by this interesting insight.
Well, much of how we narrate or tell the story of South Africa since 1994 is that we have vanquished apartheid, we have created a new just democratic order, and basically everyone lives happily ever after. And really what I'm trying to do with this book is contest that idea and show that apartheid not only didn't die in 1994, but has taken on a new life, especially in the private sphere of our lives where we interact outside of the power of the state. And this fundamentally rethinks where we are as a country, what we've achieved since 1994, and what we still have to do to dismantle apartheid in all its forms.
And after nearly 400 years of colonial and apartheid history, don't you think it is inevitable that the effects of this history will still be very much present in South Africa?
Well, I think so. But when you look at the way that we talk about our country, often you can be forgiven for thinking that we haven't accepted that. Many people believe that the Constitution has inaugurated a fundamentally different era. Many people believe that by extending the vote to all South Africans over the age of 18, we have struck a fatal blow to colonialism and apartheid. And what I'm trying to do with this book is contest that idea and to suggest that apartheid, in some cases, not all, is capable of adapting around the constraints which we placed for it in 1994. And so I'm trying to halt the excessive celebration of what democratic South Africa means and reframe just how serious the problem of apartheid still is in our society and our country.
And do you think more could have been done in the constitutional negotiations in the early 1990s to have made it easier for post-1994 governments to improve the economic lives of South Africans?
Well, yes, but I think that when we frame the question like that, another way of framing it is saying, you know, did Mandela sell out, quote unquote, or sometimes did the ANC sell out? I think we put the cart before the horse, because the problem is that the ANC didn't have full power to negotiate a completely just transition. The better question, I believe, that I ask in my book is, what did those who were negotiating on behalf of apartheid want in the negotiations? And then when we look at South Africa today, what did they get? And I think that reframes the conversation away from assuming that the ANC had all the power towards realizing that apartheid came to the negotiating table with power, with resources, and with a plan, and that parts of that plan have made it into South Africa's post-democratic, post-constitutional life. And so I'm trying to figure out, what did the apartheid negotiators want? What did they get? And how much of that survives today?
And some argue that the democratic constitution is not really the source of our problems, but that government has put in place policies to implement the vision and principles outlined in the constitution. Would you agree with this?
Well, Sis Tabi, I think there's some merit to that approach, but it also leaves the constitution away from scrutiny. And ultimately, I think we need to scrutinize both things. First, we do need to look at the democratic government as led by the ANC and realize that in many ways it has betrayed its promise. It has failed spectacularly on the basics of governance, let alone massive corruption and economic mismanagement. Having said that, I think even if we did have a perfect, benevolent, efficient government, South Africa would still be struggling from some of its structural inequalities. And that's because I argue in the book that although the constitution advances South Africa in many directions, the conception of justice, which is espoused in the constitution, is limited. And that limited conception prevents us from creating a more just society than we currently have. And so I think we need to both question the constitution while also keeping government accountable.
And on a more personal note, you say that apartheid still touches your own life. Can you please tell us more about this?
Well, I was aware when I was writing the book that to invoke apartheid is a serious and a solemn thing, especially for someone in my generation. But what I wanted to demonstrate was that even for someone like me, who has, you know, experienced relative privilege, gone to good schools, never experienced material want, my Blackness precedes me as it precedes every Black South African. And I have long lines of my family who will never overcome, you know, the structural constraints of racialized poverty. And the times I've experienced racism are too many to mention. So if apartheid still affects me, how much more those who are yet to taste any of the fruits of freedom? And I think those who look back on South Africa, say in 100 years from now, will notice how much apartheid is still part of our lives. So why don't we notice it? And why have we made it a word that no one's allowed to speak anymore? I think that only serves those who want apartheid to self-perpetuate.
And your book provides a lot of fascinating data and maps showing how racially segregated South Africa continues to be. What are your suggestions as to how such racial and spatial inequality could be overcome?
Well, to be honest, the book really doesn't try to offer solutions to many of these problems. Its main aim is first to define the monumental scale of the problem and to make us realize how serious it is. However, in the concluding chapter, much as I tried not to, I did start to focus on conclusions. And all I can say is that the problem of spatial segregation, just like the problem of the Constitution, just like the problem of technology and many of the problems I cite in the book, cannot be solved as specific problems alone. We need a grand vision that is as ambitious as the apartheid vision was across multiple sectors of our society that's implemented simultaneously all at once in order to uproot apartheid in all its places. So if we just focus on spatial segregation, well, then education will compromise that and the healthcare system will compromise that. What was unique about apartheid was that it was a grand vision that was implemented simultaneously and with great speed and great urgency. And the only way to uproot apartheid in all its forms is to do the exact same thing with the exact same urgency across multiple dimensions of our society. And how we summon the energy and the foresight to do that is our generation's current challenge. But that's the scale at which I think we need to be thinking.
And talk to us more on the underlying tension between the private law and constitutional ambitions, as you contend that much of the new apartheid is facilitated by private law, specifically the law of contract.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, as I argue that apartheid did not die, it was privatized. One of the key places to understand how this works is the realm of private law. Now, in constitutional theory, and you know, if you go to law school, you'll be taught that the Constitution is supreme. All law that is inconsistent with the Constitution is invalid. And therefore, the Constitution will always prevail when there's a clash between a constitutional value and a value that's contained, say, in a previous precedent that clashes. However, in practice, what I try to do is look at the empire of private law in South Africa, the empire of private contracts, you know, between you and who you happen to be leasing property from, or you and who you happen to be in a contractual relationship with your cell phone provider. Imagine how many contracts there really are in South Africa. There are hundreds of millions in place at any time for the 50 million citizens. And I really question whether the Constitution and its intentions and its declarations can actually overturn the momentum of apartheid in the private realm, especially in the realm of private contracts. And so that I show controversially that although the Constitution is supposed to be supreme in theory, in practice, often private legal congress can subvert constitutional aims. And the Constitutional Court can only hear so many cases in a year or even a decade. there's no way that the Constitution can solve all of these private, hundreds of millions of private contractual relationships.
And in concluding your book, you make an argument for changes to the electoral system, for changes to the structure of parliament, and the reduction in the president's powers. Why could you prioritize such restructuring, and how do you think it will assist?
Well, what I tried to do in the conclusion is say, okay, we have defined the problem and we have defined its scale. And now we need to start thinking through solutions. And what will be insufficient is to say, well, we need to change one policy here and we need to, you know, improve efficiencies there, because the new apartheid is so deep rooted that even small changes will not have any impact. So what we need to do is think about the very way in which we constitute South Africa at the moment and start looking towards what I call a second democratic republic. So what we would have had in the first three decades is the first democratic republic. Okay, there were some good things and there were some bad things. And now we need to learn the lessons to transcend the first republic into the second republic. And that requires looking closely at the constitution, appreciating the gains that it makes, but also some of the drawbacks that are contained in the text, and fundamentally restructuring everything from the separation of powers to the powers of the president, to how we elect people, to looking at questions of land and economic redistribution and bringing them more into the constitution. Is our conception of gender in the constitution outdated? Do we need to make this a more expansive conception to deal with the scourge and the horrific rate of mass crimes against women in South Africa? So I really want us, and I'm trying to provoke us, to think more deeply about how we reconfigure our country, because I think three decades of evidence now prove conclusively that something is fundamentally broken, something is fundamentally wrong, and we haven't yet summoned the tools to fix and to ameliorate the major injustices and inequalities.
And lastly, in few words, what do you make of the political state of South Africa currently? And what would be your priorities to help the country to turn a corner and become a better place?
I think South Africa is in a major prolonged political crisis. I think that President Ramaphosa's ascension to the presidency of the ANC in the country has wrong-footed many people. And it has given a sense of false hope, and everybody took their foot off the pedal of accountability and thought that things were going to change just because we had a new president. And suddenly, 3 years later, we turn around and we realize things have got worse, not better, on many fronts, from governance to corruption to economic performance. And so I believe fundamentally that we need to imagine South Africa beyond the ANC. We may not have found the perfect configuration of what that looks like. We may not have found the perfect opposition party or even the perfect opposition political movement yet, but we need to search for that, because it's clear to me, at least, that the current people who have put us in the current problems are not going to be capable of solving the problems that they themselves have created. And so what I say in the book, particularly to people of my generation, is our task is to recreate, re-envisage, and reimagine a new political situation in South Africa and create it. And that means destroying the old, sweeping it away, and really bringing something that solves the problem that the old has created.
That was Dr. Sizwe Mbofu-Walsh speaking to Krimer Media's Polity about the new apartheid.